Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor is Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
All right, we have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right. Hey, everybody. How's it going? Welcome to Comic Book Radio. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. And this is episode 70. Tonight, my guest is Justin Murphy. Professor Murph. So yeah. Let's see what's going on in the chat, though, before we start the show and bring him on. We got Bear here. And Bear says, got my books today. Awesome delivery time. There you go. Hope you enjoy them, Bear. Thank you very much. Reverend Saber in the house. Let's see. Evening, everybody. Evening, Reverend Saber. We got Real Steel here as well. Hopefully, Real Steel, your order has arrived or will arrive soon. Manny, what's up, Manny? How's everyone doing indeed? Hope you're doing well, Manny. Blue Teddy Narrations is here too. What's up, Blue Teddy? Good evening to ya. Golden Tree TV, what's up, Golden Tree? All right. Thank you guys for being here tonight. Now, tonight I want to talk about, of course, werewolves, cryptids, legends, myths, and monsters with Justin Murphy. But Justin's also got a book called War Party. We'll talk about that a little bit too. It's on Indiegogo funding right now. It's in demand, I believe. And let's bring him on, right? Give him a welcome. A big old Comic Book Radio welcome for Professor Murph, Justin Murphy. What's up?
What's going on, Pete? Wait, I gotta get my professor glasses on. Okay.
There you go.
I am almost 50, so I do need these to draw.
Oh, well, yeah, I've needed my glasses since I was 6, so we're even.
Yeah, well, LASIK fixed that part of it, the distance thing.
There's no hope for me. No hope for me. But how are you doing, man?
Great, man. Things are going good. How about you?
Good. Yeah. Things are going. I hope you're keeping busy with War Party.
Yes, I am. It's grown to 160 pages. It's a monster.
Wow.
But I'm finally on the last issue. Issue 5 is shipping out right now. And 6 will be done in a few more months.
Fantastic, man.
Yeah.
Well, congrats.
I made it.
That's a and you're taking on everything there, right? You're doing writing and art?
Yeah, everything but colors. So.
Oh, you're doing the lettering too?
Yeah, do the lettering, the writing, the art, the pre-press. I actually have and figures, but since we're talking about monsters, this is a This is my werewolf. I haven't finished him yet. I got to finish his.
Oh, that's great.
His hands and everything, but he's fully articulated, as you can see. 28 points of articulation is pretty awesome, and all the hair is glued on and everything. You know, I painted the sculpted face, did all the like the glazing work and everything, so it looks like his teeth
Holy
are wet.
Holy smokes, man! Yeah, that looks incredible.
Thanks.
Jeez, do you have a background in that?
Well, I used to work for Hamilton Collection. They do all the the statues and things you see. Like you sometimes, I don't know if you. You know, you get like those plates from the Bradford Exchange, you know, to have like pictures of a famous movie or something, like Gone with the Wind plates or whatever. Well,
yeah.
Hamilton's owned by Bradford, and Hamilton does all the figures. So I used to do virtuals for the figures. They're like renderings before they make the sculpt. And then they would take the renderings and use those to sell to the customer. And then if it got enough orders, they'd put it forward to be sculpted. So working in that industry kind of helped me understand how to do figure work and things like that.
Wow, man. So it's got like a wireframe in there and everything?
Yeah, I mean, you can buy these bodies that are already articulated, and then I just sculpt the rest. I sculpt the hands, sculpt the feet, sculpt the head, and then put all the hair on it. You know, because my monsters are basically big muscle men. They're just, the only thing that's different is the head, the hands, and the feet, and everything else, for the most part, is, you know, pretty anatomically similar to a human. So
that's incredible.
Yeah, it's fun.
Oh, man. I wish I could do that for King Cryptid. I'm not inclined in that way. I'm not gifted or talented enough on that level, nor am I patient enough.
Well, yeah, and you have to sell them. I mean, you have to make only a few. Like, obviously, they're very time-consuming and expensive, so I only make, like, 5 or 10 of them and sell them for several $100s, and then they're gone, you know? They're not mass-produced or anything like that. You're talking $500,000 if you want to mass produce a toy.
Holy smokes. Yeah. I think I'd do one and I'm like, all right, who wants this? $1,000. I ain't doing any others.
It's a lot of work. It's fun though, you know, and it gets your IP out there. But
how long does it take you to do one of those?
That guy so far have probably already put 6 or 7 hours into it. But by the time it's done, probably I'm thinking 10. So, you know, if I budget my time minus the cost at, you know, $25-$30 an hour, that thing goes for $375, and I've already sold 5 of them.
Oh,
so,
awesome, man.
Yeah, I mean, there's people out there that'll collect those things and pay top dollar because they want, you know, sort of like an exclusive sort of limited edition product.
Yeah, yeah.
It's fun. I'm glad I have backers that are into that type of stuff, because you never know, you know.
Yeah, right? Holy smokes. Man, you're making me look bad. All I got tonight to promote is a mug. Yes, if anybody wants a mug, we got a new moon special tonight. Tomorrow's a new moon.
Oh, nice.
And we got a King Cryptid mug, a hero you can believe in. And this is art by Keir Covington, who has art also on issue 4 and 9. You can pick up the mug either at Indiegogo, kingcryptid.com, or on alternatecomics.com/kingcryptid. But
I'm enjoying it. I've read the first 3 issues. I'm still got to read issue 4, but I'm enjoying the comic. I love it. Awesome. I mean, I love that type of stuff. You know, I guess why you had me on.
Totally. Yeah.
I like the similar things in terms of the monsters and everything.
Absolutely. Actually, speaking of, hold on. I got to change my name. Tonight I got to be Paranormal Pete. Because we're gonna be diving more tonight into the weird and the odd and all that good stuff. So talk about both comics and the paranormal on the show, but a lot of the stuff when it's more paranormal heavy, I have it on a separate playlist. So this is definitely going on that. Now speaking of which, I know you got a long history with a lot of it, with being into it, you know, being well researched about it and all of that. How did that start for you?
Well, I remember it was probably 1981, I was flipping through the channels and I stopped on HBO and there was a making of documentary on American Werewolf in London. And they were talking about, you know, Rick Baker doing all the special makeup effects on camera for the werewolf transformation. And I, you know, like most boys, I was always into monsters and things like that. But something about that documentary and just seeing, you know, the process of creature creation and transformation really stuck with me. And of course that was about the time I was watching The Incredible Hulk, you know, on TV, and which is like my favorite TV. That and Dukes of Hazzard I would not miss when I was like 6 and 7 years old. And the whole thing about, you know, the transformation, turning from man to beast kind of thing, I always found that fascinating. And that's not necessarily a cryptid thing, but it is the sort of the beast inside, or, you know, the man turning into monster. And I always loved that whole idea of, you know, and the special effects behind it. And it just got me interested in that. And, you know, so I would draw monsters and things on and off throughout the years in my comic books and everything. And for a while I got into history, and I was doing strictly historical comics, Civil War type stuff. And War Party is just where the two kind of came together. You know, I took my love of history, my love of monsters and supernatural, paranormal, whatever, and just kind of merged them together. And what if you took these two worlds and just put them together? And a few years ago I did some, and you can still see it. There's a show called In Search of Monsters with William Shatner.
Oh, I love that show. Yeah.
The Unexplained.
It was with, The Unexplained with William Shatner. Yeah. Which is basically like Weird or What, but there's a couple new episodes.
It comes on History Channel, I believe, or the Travel Channel.
History Channel, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's made by Prometheus Entertainment, and they hired me to do a bunch of, and I put my DeviantArt link in there. They hired me to do a bunch of cryptid paintings, or they licensed them for use on their show. So they licensed the Chupacabra, and they licensed the Michigan Dogman. I did like 100 cryptids, just these little like trading card size paintings. And, you know, Nessie and all that. And, if you scroll down, you'll see some of them. That's a Wendigo there. That's the nice. Sea serpent on the top right. There's a giant squid. There's the butterfly people. The chupacabras on the bottom right. You got the megalodon. And that's called a leshy, the guy with the guy in the woods there. It's kind of like an Ent from Lord of the Rings.
yeah.
So, but they saw my work and they started licensing different images from me for use on their shows. And so it just kind of, you know, that kind of happened by chance. You know, they just came across my work online and they've been licensing it ever since.
So, that's awesome, man. Yeah. So I've probably seen it and I didn't even know about it.
They'll license a lot of images. Like when they talk about Chupacabra, they'll show like probably 10 Chupacabras throughout the course of the show. But mine's one of the ones that, you know, that they'll show on the show. And every year I get another check, which is great. You know, every time they use it another season, I get a check will be in the mail. Like, oh, this is nice.
That's cool, man.
Secret, kids, if you're an artist, do art that makes you money once you every night you go to bed and you're still making money, you know, or years later when you're done with it and the checks are coming in. That's the art you want to create. The art that keeps paying you over time. And they're little. They're only like this big. They're like card, trading card size.
Mm.
So they were real quick, you know, quick in and out, kind of, you know, 3 or 4 hours and I was done.
What was this originally for? Did you just do it on your own?
I wanted to do a card game called Cryptids. This was like back in 2017.
Oh, okay.
And it was just a card game where you get cards and the cryptids battle each other and they all have different sort of abilities and stuff. And, you know, I went the Kickstarter route and wasn't able to raise enough to do the game. I think I needed like $25,000 or $30,000, and it's when you don't have a network, it's really hard to raise money for games. So I just kind of said, well, I've painted all these monsters. What I'm going to do with them? I'll just throw them up on my portfolio, and then that's when Prometheus Entertainment called a year later and started licensing them. So
that's
it
awesome,
paid off
man.
In the long run. Yeah.
Terrific. I'd love to see that being used even as a just a trading card set.
That, you know what, I probably should do that because that would be cheap. Just make the
that'd
cards
be way
put
cheaper
the,
than the
yeah. Just put the facts on the back and be done with it.
Yeah,
that's a good
idea.
Thank you. I'll do that.
Yeah, because they're awesome, man. Thanks. Love them. Man, holy smokes! All right, yeah. So that's incredible. Do you have a favorite in terms of cryptids, monsters, that kind of a thing?
Well, I mean, obviously, I do think Bigfoot is real. There's something out there. That one's probably the most legitimate.
Too many people are seeing too many things for too long of a time.
Something's up with Bigfoot. I've always liked the Wendigo, which kind of plays into War Party because the Wendigo is obviously a Native American cryptid, but it's based on like a cursed shaman. It's like it's the shamans that have given themselves over to dark magic is what they believe. Or if you ever resort to cannibalism, you'll become a Wendigo.
Yeah.
I've always found that one fascinating because it's just, I also remember reading about it, you know, the Marvel version, you know, the comic where Wendigo fights Hulk.
Yeah,
I don't know if you remember that one, when they're in the snow. It was John Buscema.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a great one. I remember one of my first experiences with Wendigo was the Todd McFarlane Spider-Man Wolverine story.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was a good one, too. Yeah. But I'm going way back. I'm going back.
But
to
that's,
like
yeah, that's classic.
80s.
That's awesome
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember reading that as about 6 years old, and I was just fascinated by it. And then when it got to the history, how he was like locked up in the, they're out in the snow or whatever, and his friend died and all that. It was talking about that in the book. You know, when you're 6 years old, that's like, that's heavy stuff, you know?
Totally.
That stuff. So it made an impact. And, you know, so there's obviously a connection there with the whole war party and a Native American thing.
It's funny, man, because, and I don't want to harp on my own book, but we have a lot of similarities between King Cryptid's kind of story. It's a little bit of that historical fiction.
Do I sense a guest cover appearance, maybe?
Well, I always need... So the front covers, because we got front and back covers. So the front covers are always the interior artist. They get they get the prestige. But I'm always looking for the back cover to be done by somebody else. So who knows, man? I got a lot of these issues to tell.
Or a variant, maybe?
And a lot of...
King Cryptid makes a variant guest appearance on a War Party issue, man.
I mean, then maybe. Maybe
Dionysus hanging out with
I got a lot of issues to get out there, so yeah, I could see you on the back cover one day putting something together. That'd be cool. But yeah, man, it's interesting because there is kind of this crossover with those sort of things, and there is a lot of Native American mythology as well within King Cryptid too. We get to it in issue 4, but we really get into it as the series goes on. But there's all kinds of mythology that comes together because you can't really evade it. You know, there's a lot of that, like we were talking about with the Bigfoot. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not... I've met some people that think Bigfoot is literally just there's one. It's Bigfoot. Like he's Mr. Bigfoot.
Right, right.
And he's everywhere all the time, you know? Like, because they're like, well, they see him everywhere. And I'm like, what if there's just a lot of them? You know, like you see like a dog, you know, or and then you see the same kind of breed of a dog and then the same kind of breed. It doesn't mean that dog's going everywhere and just being that, since that one dog. It means that there's a lot of that breed of a dog, you know?
Well, and the Pacific Northwest is huge. I mean, they can't even see it from like if you're in a helicopter, it's so dense, you can't even see through the tree cover. Like you'd have to get down there and explore it all. And the best story is that one, I'm sure you've heard it, back in the early 1900s, or it might have been the late 1800s, it's around the turn of the century, where the hunters were attacked in the cabin. I don't know if you've heard that story where, I mean, it was in the newspapers at the time and everything, that they were in
the
cabin.
Is that the one that they were trying to write it off as a bear?
Yeah, and they were saying, no, this thing was throwing... overhand throwing, which monkeys can't do that. Apes can't do that. Monkeys, they can't throw overhand. They can only do underhand. That's a human trait. And they were overhand throwing rocks and things at the cabin, and they were having to shoot through the windows, and there were more than one of them, and they were surrounding the cabin, and they were making all sorts of grunting noises, and they're like, these were not people. We were not being attacked by, you know, anything human at all. But at the same time, it was obviously not a bear or, you know, your typical wilderness animal. So it's a fascinating story. It's probably the best story I've ever heard that definitely gives some credence to the whole thing, that there's something out there.
Yeah, yeah. I definitely think there is some kind of, because people I've heard, they don't necessarily think that there's Bigfoot because they think, well, where's the body, where's this, where's, you know, the proof of evidence and things like that. I do think there's a cover-up behind it. Do you think that there's one? Do you think that there's a reason for why they maybe could have these bodies and a hard proof of these things, but they don't want to reveal it?
Well, I mean, think about, you know, I'm always running across dead bear carcasses and deer carcasses in the woods. I've never seen a carcass of an animal, and I've been in the woods a lot in my life. They get eaten, they deteriorate, they rot.
Very short amount of time.
Yeah, they get ripped apart by the wild animals. So this notion that, well, if they're out there, we would have found one. Well, no, not necessarily. Like I said, now the one thing they say is because they're so big, how could they possibly sustain themselves? But, I mean, they're probably herbivores. They probably eat a lot of plants, you know, just like a gorilla. They probably eat a lot of, you know, greenery. They're probably constantly eating, or they could eat other animals. Who knows? But as far as a cover-up, I mean, who knows, right? I mean, what would be the reason? I don't know. I mean, it's
the biggest reason I have is this. And this is, I don't know how old this kind of theory is. It's not my own. It's one I heard about, and I was like, that kind of explains a lot. Is the interdimensional slash extraterrestrial theory.
Yeah, that they're actually not of this dimension.
So you get one in, and then you examine it, and you're like, this thing's not from here. Or we can't explain the DNA, or we can't explain a lot about this thing. And that would be a very big reason to pipe up about Sasquatches.
Yeah, if it definitely denies science, not denies science, but like contradicts our understanding of things that are, well, like the thing in Mexico. Who knows if that's real? I'm sure you heard that story today.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Or Peru, yeah, the thing they found in Peru that looks like an alien and it's a little body.
Yeah, the two Peruvian mummies and yeah. They're like 1,000 years old, and I look at that and I'm like, man, that just looks like someone sort of did something to a capuchin monkey. And then
yeah, it's hard to tell because it's so hard to, like, rigid. The face is weird though, the way it's
yeah, like, it looks like you know, in Twilight Zone, in that episode where they're wearing the masks, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because their eyes are huge. Yeah. You know, it kind of has that vibe of like it had to always wear something, and it almost shaped its skull. It kind of sucked it out, and it would have had like a thing it wore, and you never really would have saw the eyes. The thing that I have a problem with that is that if it was mummified, that means that it was revered and they wanted to preserve it. Mm. But that means that also whatever craft, whatever else it had to do with anything, they probably would have wanted to preserve that too. Now, again, that could have been confiscated, but at the same time, you know, if they brought out like this little dude's craft, with the little mummy on display inside of the glass coffin thing there, that would have been kind of more difficult to, even though it's very difficult for me to buy into it when it's any government bringing this out. And I know that's contradictory, because you would want that to be kind of verified in some way.
Well, and there's obviously a motive why they're saying. Coming out and saying already, without even doing any DNA testing or anything, that, oh, this is, you know, not of this world. Well,
yeah, and like they've done X-ray and whatever, and it looks kind of odd and all of that, but I'm just like,
yeah, it's,
I don't know.
It could be a distraction, you know, from the fact that the economy is about to collapse.
Or like, the whole world is
World
on
War
the
III.
Brink, yeah. You know?
We got to come up with something. Oh, I know.
Yeah, because there's a lot of stuff that they could do, and I mean, I'm sure you are well versed in a lot of the history of all this stuff, but there's a lot of stuff they could bring forth and kind of finally disclose that would be a little bit more like, yeah, okay. Well, but when they throw this crazy one out of left field.
Well, it's the magician's trick usually with governments where, you know, watch what this hand is doing, because I don't want you to pay attention to what this hand is doing, so... and that's probably 9 times out of 10. That's probably what it is. But it is interesting. I mean, it is bizarre, and maybe we'll get some more information about it. But
yeah,
what if they come back and say the DNA has been tested and it's not of this earth? Then what are you gonna do?
That's the thing, right? Is that I'm so just not believing anything that comes out of the mouth of any government that I'm like, of course they'd say that. Even the thing with David Grush and that coming out with him being a whistleblower, and everyone's well, you know, he testified in front of Congress, and that means something, because if he's lying, you know, there's a penalty for it. And I'm like, yeah, but what if he's just supposed to do all of that? Mm. You know, what if he's just supposed to be the whistleblower guy, and he's supposed to come out and say, here's a bunch of things I've seen and or what I've talked to people about or whatever, but I can't give public facts about that. You know, we can talk about it in a closed session because it's still sort of classified, and I'm just like, none of that matters to me, because there's so much history behind it. There's so many things. There's so many stories. There's so much evidence from other people in even more official positions that have come out and said certain things. And then there's a long history of assassinations and things that look like they definitely were an assassination, but they said it wasn't an assassination. That just, it, you know, you read into the story of it, and it's like, okay, well, that guy was going to kind of start talking about this stuff. And then He just fell out of a window one day.
know? His car, he lost control of his car, and it just happened to drive right into the side of a telephone pole. You know?
A lot of weird heart attacks and people's 30s and stuff. And so it's very strange.
So what you're saying is we need to stop talking about this right now, is what you're saying.
I'm saying we should talk about it until someone bursts through the door and, well, actually, that's a little bit of a thing for me.
Exactly. You've been there, done that.
I've been there, done that. I wish it was for something that was more controversial than just something to do with comic books. You know?
Well.
But, yeah. Man, oh, man. But it's almost like, for me, I think at this point, I'm not saying that I want to invite this on my doorstep ever again. That was horrible for me and for my wife in particular. But it's a weird... Like when you have a out of body experience or a near death experience sort of thing, and almost like you kind of been there, and you seen what it's like, and you kind of go, there's a lot to life, and I should probably talk about it. And if I go down, I'm gonna go down swinging.
No, I mean, yeah, it's a good truth matters.
Yeah,
I mean, we can't. Part of the tactic, obviously, is to use fear to shut people up and to quit people from becoming curious about things, which is what they want. They don't want curiosity, and they don't want, they want you to go about your business and be a good little soldier.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
With regards to everything. So, no, you're exactly right. What's the point of living if you're not going to pursue truth?
Yeah, and at least explore the possibility, even if all it is just using your imagination, being curious about it, having conversations like this. You know, the fact that they get people to self-censor all the time, for fear of something. I don't know. I mean, I was never one for peer pressure when I was a kid. That never really worked on me. And sometimes for better or worse, but it's one of those things where I think we're starting to see more and more people talk about this stuff. It's definitely it's always been this open public secret, So that's why I think, and Lady Ribbit puts it well, where it's like, I don't think people are as impressed with the alien stuff anymore. And I think it's because they've been just talking about it in some way, shape or form for decades, that they could just come out with it and be like, yeah. All of it's real. All of it happened. We lied. It's all true. We just did this at the time because we didn't know how people react. And we got technology. We've got bodies. We've got even some of them living here. We'd still talk to them. We communicate. And people would be like, yeah, I knew that. Yeah.
Or like you said, we're so jaded with regards to government truth and lies that we may not even believe that.
Yeah.
They come out and say, here are the bodies. Well, how do I know that's real? How do I know you didn't just make that? How do I know that's not a prop? How do I know?
Right.
Even that, people aren't even believing their own eyes anymore. And now with AI coming into the play, we're really not going to believe our own eyes anymore. So how do you prove anything anymore? I mean, it's going to become really difficult to prove anything with video or any sort of visual evidence at all, unless you're there touching it, tangibly interacting with it. How are you going to know that's even real?
Oh, totally. Yeah. Now, when it comes to monsters and these legendary kind of creatures and things like that, when you're working them into your stories, is there any kind of specific angle that you approach with that? Are you going into it and you're just flat out adapting a pre-existing creature, or are you creating some of your own? Are you hybridizing? How are you working with
that?
Well,
I mean, mine's more about being a skinwalker or shapeshifter, so they're not cryptids per se, but they're animals that, there's whatever your totem is. So I just did a gatefold cover, and I put it up on Twitter for the last issue, and if you open the back flap of the gatefold, it's got other beasts that are the warriors, the Native Americans, part of Dione's tribe. And one of them's a goose. He's a were-goose. I mean, one of them's a bobcat. One of them's a cardinal.
Is he like a human-sized goose?
He's a were-goose. So he's got arms and a goose head and wings. That's his totem. I mean, so whatever your totem is, that's all she can transform you into. So if your totem is a groundhog, or your totem is, an aardvark or a turtle, I won't do turtles because that's a little too close to TMNT, but you get my point.
Poor turtles.
Yeah. So they're humanized hybrid versions, werewolf, whatever, were versions of what it. So they're not really cryptids per se. However, I did take a legendary creature called, well, you've all heard of the Baphomet, or most of you have.
Mm.
In my issue zero, these two characters.
Hold on, let me full screen you.
That's Zoltana, which is the woman, and Hakan is her husband. They share the same totem, which is the Sabbatic goat. It's the goat. Mm. And they have been offering their children up to this demon, and they want supernatural power. So the demon gives them the shape-shifting power, but because they share the same totem as a goat, they both merge together simultaneously. So what happens is, instead of them each becoming a were-goat, they come together, and I'll have to cover this up for your family-friendly show, because it is a trans, you know, Baphomet's male and female, if you've ever seen drawings. So it's those two people. What I did is I took the Baphomet and I made my characters, Zoltana and Hakan, are actually the Baphomet throughout history. That's that people know as that demon. And they become the were-goat, receiving the powers from this demon. So what I've done is taken sort of a legendary, not necessarily cryptid, but the Baphomet is known throughout occult history as a paranormal demon or entity that feasts on the blood of children, which is really what War Party's all about. All of my War Party stories are about, like in this one, Dione's trying to rescue a child that's been abducted by one of the pioneers, one of the frontier fighters, and he's trying to get his daughter back. Well, the reason why they're taking these children is, you know, because they like to basically defile innocents. Traditionally through the occult, the defiling of the innocents brings power to the practitioner. So that, which is why they've been offering their children up to this demon. So Dione fights these forces throughout time, because she ages very slowly. And my follow-up series is going to take place in the 1970s. So we're going a full 200 years into the future, during the Son of Sam shootings in New York, when Manhattan goes blacks out, and it's called War Party Blackout, and it's when Manhattan goes dark in 1977, and the Son of Sam is running around killing people. And I basically am taking the story of the dog that Berkowitz said was talking to him. You know, he's like, the dog was telling me to kill people, my neighbor's dog. I don't know if you've heard that.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, what's a talking dog? Wait a minute, that's a werewolf. I was like, so I'm, there's a cult that he's associated with called the Process Church. This is something they've talked about. And I was like, that would make a great springboard for this whole Process Church thing that meets out in Yonkers in this abandoned park and commits all these like sacrifices and stuff. They're going around creating negative fear and energy throughout New York by assisting with all these shootings. And what they're trying to do is bring back these two. Because Dione had defeated them at some point in history, and they're trying to bring back the Baphomet. And Dione's living in New York at the time and finds out about this. And because she, you know, they kind of have been battling each other all throughout time. And they come together again in the 1970s. So I'm taking a lot of occult lore, a little bit of serial killer stuff, history, werewolves, monsters, Wendigos in there a little bit. So there's some cryptid elements, and it's all just kind of coming together in these stories. And I'm having a blast with it. It's fun to write, and it's fun to draw. So.
I'm always fascinated by the use of language in terms of we say certain things, and we just do it so flippantly because we think they're figures of speech, like someone's battling their demons. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Things like that. And meanwhile, if you research enough and you go into history, especially, you don't even have to go that far back, and then you can see that there's literally all these things that were associated with demonic possession that would make people behave in a certain way. And there's all these demons that have these names that you're attached, and then that's what makes it feel that way. And, you know, and it's very strange that then in modern times we use these terminologies and these kinds of figures of speech. And we probably don't even realize that maybe there's some truth to that. Even when I look at, I don't know if you ever done this, when you're looking at certain movies or shows, and they're doing like the rituals and they're saying the things and they got all the stuff and they put the little pentagrams and they have all the everything together, right? And I'm like, I know it's a movie and that's fictional, but they put that together somewhere at that point in time, and they did that stuff over and over again. The iconography, the scripture, saying the passage. What a front it could potentially all be.
Yeah, well, I mean, I believe in, you know, spiritual forces, definitely. I'm personally a Christian and everything. But when I was younger, I don't know if you ever heard of Black Shuck. It was a dog. Look him up. It was a dog in the Middle Ages in Europe that attacked a congregation.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And he came into the church. He attacked people. Yep. He killed the priest, and he knocked over a bunch of candles, and the church caught on fire, and he ran to the doors.
I thought it was a hellhound.
Yeah, and I don't know if his paws caught on fire or what the heck happened, but he clawed the door, and to this day, there's still burned claw marks on this door, and he ran out. It was in the newspapers and everything. This was not made up. You know, these people weren't imagining it. This really happened. But ever since then, he's been regarded as some sort of demonic entity. When I was younger, it was about the time my parents were getting divorced, and I was sort of like going through some, you know, like personal, you know, I was like 12 years old. I was going through a lot of personal, emotional trauma. You know, a lot of times when you're going through stuff like that, of course, you could have nightmares or things can come that, you know, terrify you at night because you're in such a state, a traumatic state, which is my point with the whole fear thing, like the blackout. There's an energy that comes from fear and terror or uncertainty. And when people are in that place, things come in.
Yeah.
Things feed on that.
Everything's a frequency. I mean, to get scientific, everything's a frequency, a resonance.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And I woke up one night and there was this black wolf sitting at the foot of my bed. And, you know, I was lucent, but I was partly sleeping, but I couldn't tell if it was a dream. I couldn't tell how much it was awake, but I could see the room. And there he was. And I mean, I just screamed and screamed and screamed and called out to God. And then I went back to sleep. And then the next day, you know, I remembered it. And it only happened again one other time in my life. So what I did was, and this is not War Party related, but I've been doing an animated film called Dogtown for 10 years now, because I teach animation at my school.
Is it about the Massachusetts village?
No. It's about an illegal dogfighting ring where a pit bull gets taken, and he's trying to help lead an escape of the dogs out of the ring. It's a hand-drawn animated movie. But throughout the movie, he keeps seeing this black dog, and he keeps telling the other dogs, "I'm seeing this black. It looks like a wolf. What is this?" And they're all freaking out because they're like, "That's their death." In other words, that's death. So if you see Black Shuck, it means you're gonna die. So they're basically warning him that the fact that you're seeing this dog means that you're time is up, like your days are numbered. This was before Puss in Boots came out, by the way, one that's out right now with death and all that. So he keeps seeing Black Shuck throughout the course of the film, and it's like death is coming after him the whole time. And I don't want to ruin the movie and everything, but it's gonna be great. I'll probably have it done another 2 or 3 years. It's got George Foreman in it. Stacey Dash from Clueless is in it, and Jason Begay from Chicago PD. I have, you know, three sort of names in there. But that's beside the point. The point is, yes, I do try to put, if you want to call Black Shuck a cryptid, he's more paranormal. I did put him in there. So I do try to put any kind of spiritual, paranormal, occult type stuff in my stories, because I think everything that happens in this realm starts in that realm. Like, you know, just like something starts with an idea before you do it, things happen in the spiritual first, and then they manifest in the physical. And back and forth. And we kind of live in a time where people just want to deny this, that this spiritual exists. That makes them uncomfortable, so they don't want to talk about it. And it's I think it's to your detriment to ignore that aspect of life.
Totally. Yeah, and I think if anything, especially even when people talk about certain things within science, and it's either it's black and white science, or, you know, it's got to be spiritual. Like thinking in terms of creation or anything else, or, you know, people go and poo-poo all over prayer, but then they'll talk up meditation. Mm-hmm. And it's like we're basically right. talking about the same things.
Right.
You know, there's so many things that are considered metaphysical today that in 50 years from now, they're going to be like, yeah, what are you talking about? We know what that is. Just yeah. like how there are things that from, you know, 300-400 years ago that you would have been burned at the stake or crushed or whatever. You know, and today we're just like, yeah, that's pretty obvious, you know? And it's so much of that. To deny that part of it, I think, is such a bad move for just everything in general, because it's absolutely true. The evidence is there across the board. And if anything, that stuff is far older than anything that we can comprehend with modern science. And well, it's been around for so long.
And it's interesting. And honestly, it makes life more interesting. I mean, who wants to be so mundane and boring as to believe that this is all there is? This stuff you're touching right here.
And I think that's the point.
That's it. You know, I mean, there's no... Then you have just robbed... Yep. life of all of its power, all of its magic, all of its wonder.
Don't just, wonder, don't dream, no yeah. imagination. You're don't a meat be inspired.
Suit. You're a meat yeah. suit with a brain, and you're gonna die, and that's it.
Yeah, well, don't look into something further. Don't question right. anything. You know, and we had the doctrine in religion that squashed things, and now we have the new doctrine of religion and science, which squashes things. Either way, they're still played out the same way. Because to me, I don't know if you feel the same way, but to me, spirituality is different from the religion, tradition, doctrine, etc., the ritual aspect of it. Mm-hmm. But in terms of what I think we need to do as people to move forward in a complete way, we really need to embrace the fact that things are unknown and we don't really know a whole hell of a lot. And there are some things answered by spirituality and even right. things like consciousness. That we can be fancy with it and talk about it in a scientific way, even though most scientists don't want to talk about consciousness because it's this intangible sort of thing. Mm. But meanwhile, then they'll talk about it in a roundabout way without using the word to describe. So you mean consciousness? So it's really funny listening to some of the stuff that goes on, getting around it. Because they don't want to be denied funding, they don't want to lose right. their jobs, they don't want to, you know, all of that. And it's so crazy to see that we're in this mode where we want everyone to just think what we know today is all we'll ever know, all we'll ever need to know. Don't wonder about anything. And if we, the authority, come up with something new, we'll let you know.
Right, right. Well, and that's why the whole cryptid thing and just keeping... What's good about UFOs, aliens, cryptids, spiritual things, all of that, demons, angels, all of that, is it keeps you open to possibility. Like, the worst thing to do is to be somebody who's not open to possibility of things beyond your understanding. That's death. I mean, just, especially for an artist. I mean, if you're going to have any kind of imagination or create anything, you've got to always be open to possibility. And that's the thing that, for whatever reason, culture likes to try to squash. They don't want possibility. They want to tell you this is how it is, and you know, sit yeah, in this yeah. box, you know, and that's it.
So. Yeah, it's weird because they'll do that to creative thinkers and to people that question the system, and then you know they'll do even horrible things to them, whatever. Maybe even execute some of these people too. And then 100, 200, 300 years or whatever it is, here's a statue, you know, we've named a park after them, a city after them, we've given a nice quaint apology.
And then 50 years later, they're tearing the statue down.
Yeah.
<it's> just, it goes in cycles.
Madness. Lady Ribbit says, Justin, do you think it's possible the dream dog on your bed was protecting you?
No, because... the way it looked, I felt an evil presence in the room, and it was emanating from this creature. It looked hideous. It was, so I don't think that's the case, but
because
it's a yeah. nice thought, but no, yeah. It wasn't like it was a little fluffy Shih Tzu there, you know.
Because that's the thing for me. I've experienced something similar. It wasn't in the shape of a dog, and I experienced it about I'd say maybe three times. Two times it was unbelievably terrifying. The third time I was kind of able to shift a bit and just it would eventually subside. And it's kind of like that shadow people sort of thing.
Yeah, I was going to mention that because my sister experienced that where yeah. you had that thing sitting. you wake up and it's sitting on your chest.
Yeah,
see, that, there's those, paintings of this. You know?
Yeah, it's like an those imp. Were the two times and it was insane. And yeah. One of them, the creepiest one, it was moving down towards me. And I've had this story before, and I guess I'll have to say it again. So some people, I'm sorry about your nightmares tonight. but then there's been other times where I've felt, and it's about feeling the energy. It's a very negative, oppressive, anxiety feeling that you get. Whereas I've experienced other kinds of feelings within either dreams or in that state in between, where it was almost like a peace, like a calmness, and it was very positive, and it was a very different kind of energy and entity associated with it.
Oh yeah, you'll feel it right away. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
If you're in the presence of even a tiny sliver of evil, you can feel it. Like it's there. It's palpable. That's when people go, well, there's no such thing as evil. I'm like, well, number one, you've never studied history. And number two, you must have not had very many spiritual experiences in your life, because there definitely is, evil definitely exists. In whatever
yeah, and
form
it,
you
and it does
it.
Vibe. There is yeah. a vibe to it. Yeah. And so this thing, I was in Gloucester, Massachusetts at the time, which was funny when you brought up Dogtown, because Dogtown Village was Gloucester. Cape Ann area, and this area was really haunted. We were living there for about 4 years. Within like the first 2 months, we started experiencing stuff, and we never stopped experiencing stuff. It was a very strange area. We heard a lot of noises. There was a lot of weird energies, but this one thing in particular, it was probably, I don't know, I'd say it was just at breaking dawn, and I'm in the state of between wake and sleep, and this shadow figure is just standing huge. It's probably like 8 feet tall, almost up to the ceiling, and it was kind of cloaked, like you could see the figure of a human, but you couldn't make out appendages or nothing. I couldn't see anything like that, and it just slowly came closer to me, and I'm just like, what the hell is this? I remember like having to think of like what is going on. And it was almost like a fog, the way it was drifting, very kind of slow down, and into my face, right into my face, got to the side. I was on my side on the bed, and I could see it from the corner of my eye getting closer, and I'm just like, please just go away. Please just go away. And it gets right up to my face, where I start to see a little more detail to it. And what it was, it was dark. It was like a shadow, almost a little translucent, where I can see still through it, and I could still picture it. The eye area and the big mouth area, dark. Unbelievably dark, like pitch black dark.
It's like a Dementor.
It's very strange, very strange. And it gets right in my front of my face. And the mouth gets huge, drops all the way down. And it's screaming, but there's no noise coming out. The only reason that I could say it's screaming is because you know that feeling you get when you feel like a train or a plane rumble through and it breaks the sound barrier or whatever it is, and you feel the rumble, the vibration inside. At that moment when the mouth got huge, I felt like that vibration hitting my chest.
Wow.
And it was just, and I heard like that kind of pinging noise when your ears ring. And I was, it just did that for about 5 seconds, and then poof, it just dispersed. And I was like,
that sounds like a demon, Pete.
Needless to say, we don't live there anymore.
Yeah.
But and across the street, I've said this before, across the street where we lived, it was on a hill. Mm-hmm. And across the street, it was only our side of the apartment complex where you could see this one side mm-hmm. of it. And this place was up there, and they would do weird things all the time, all weird ceremonies. And then in the morning, they'd be rolling down big barrels of, like, it was like toxic waste that would be, like, you would see the signs on it and everything, like hazardous waste materials. But you'd see, like, around all the time, 3 a.m., especially around solstices and things like that, you'd see candles. We'd see candles just of people marching around, and you'd see the light moving like this. And I was like, there is weird stuff happening over there. We'd see cloaked people, yeah. Hooded figures, things like that.
This is in Massachusetts?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of spiritual activity there. Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. It's just like the Bigfoot thing with the amount of sightings. There are countless stories like the one you're talking about. like you said, with shadow people, people seeing people in their room at night, people sit things sitting on their chest. There's even famous paintings about it, you know, with the imp on the body and everything. And people try to explain away, well, that's your mind, it's your psyche, it's your dream state, it's a lucid dream, da 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 da. I'm like, no, 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 no. There's more to it than that. Obviously, you know, I take that as evidence, honestly. I don't see it as just, well, that's your personal experience, and I'm not. Because I will give you another one that's actually very positive, or neutral. Me being a big Civil War buff, back in 2000, I had written a musical with a guy up in New York. It was like a Civil War musical and everything. And we were finished with it. We were trying to get it on Broadway and all this stuff. We went to Gettysburg, and we were walking the field on Gettysburg that day. And we went, I don't know if you know much about the Battle of Gettysburg, but there's a place called the High Water Mark, which is where Robert E. Lee was, it's called Pickett's Charge, and it was like the last day of the battle, and he was basically just going to hit the Federal center. And try to end the battle and win it. And so we got to the High Water Mark, which is where the Confederates reached the wall, and the Federal troops, there was a lot of hand-to-hand combat there. It was very brutal. Like, desperate fighting went on there. Some of the most desperate of the war. And we were standing there by the wall, and he was about 20 feet away, and he had his back turned to me, and I'm standing there, and all of a sudden I feel like, you know, like when you put your tongue on a 9-volt.
You get that charge.
Yeah. Started at the feet, went up the legs, up the body, through my head, whole body, as if I was plugged into a light socket. That's what it felt. It was just like, you know, like there's electricity surging through your body. My friend Roger turns around, looks at me, and he goes, "Do you feel that?" I was like, dude, they talk about hallowed ground, you know, where like something desperate happened, like either a lot of blood was shed, a lot of people
died. Yeah, a lot of that residual energy.
Dude, it's there, man. And I was like, and it's not like you're going to feel it every time. It's not like everybody that walks through there feels it. And I've never felt it since. And I've been a lot of other battlefields that are just as bloody. But for some reason, that day, that moment, that spot, it hit us both simultaneously. And I mean, there was no denying it, especially when he turned around and confirmed it. I'm like, this is not my imagination. Wow. We're both feeling this thing. So, and it wasn't a negative. It was very neutral, but it was definitely tangible. You could feel it. So there's something to it. I mean,
you know. Oh, totally. I mean, yeah, to get super scientific about it, you know, you get electromagnetic frequencies, you got everything swarming around, you've got all kinds of signals in the air at this point in time, where some of them are either amplifying or insulating and kind of muffling and subduing the effects of certain things. I'm sure all of it's wreaking havoc on anything within us that can sense this sort of stuff. But it's just... It's insane when you do feel that sort of thing, and you do get that energy, that pulse.
Well, and especially when it's somewhere that you know something like that happened.
Yeah.
Like that's the only reason why I don't count it. Like, well, maybe, you know, it was an electrical charge coming up through the earth. I'm like, no, 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 no. We're literally at the high water mark of the battle. Some of those desperate fighting. People died here in a very desperate hand-to-hand fight. There's no doubt in my mind. That ground is consecrated right there, which is why it's important to preserve places like that. And it's also why, you know, a lot of times you'll hear about when there's a lot of spiritual trouble somewhere, you find out like they built the place on an Indian burial ground.
Yeah, you're some like, place that's sacred.
Yes, yeah. Yes. And you don't want to mess with that stuff because it doesn't go away. It stays, whatever you want to call that. And there are points in the earth they call power spots, and this
is with the ley lines and everything else.
And occultists believe that if they conduct certain rituals, they believe like Stonehenge is one of them. If you conduct certain rituals at these locations, that you will generate more power in the ritual because of where you are on the earth. So,
which is interesting again too, because at that point in time when they were doing all that, they don't run around with like an EMF detector,
right?
You know,
yeah, I mean,
so
how did they know?
Well, how did they know?
Probably the way we just experienced it, like I told you with Gettysburg. Yeah. They probably could feel it, like coming. They were the detector.
Yeah, there's a resonance. Yes. It's a lot more quiet. There's not any of this electromagnetic interference from devices and signals and radar and satellite and everything else coming down. Mm-hmm. So you're way more open to being able to feel those energies. Just even in certain places, you know, you can go into certain spots that are just quiet and away from civilization a bit and start to feel like the silence of certain places. And then certain places that it's almost like it should be silent, but you feel something. There is an energy there. And it's interesting. I just wanted to say one story here with G.J. Martinez. This is pretty interesting. It goes, reminds me of the legend of the white dog and black dog from El Salvador. The white dog is the protector and the black dog with the red eyes is evil. My grandfather experienced this in his youth. Says he came home really late from work. As he was walking home, he saw a black dog with red eyes appear and started to follow him. But at some point, a white dog also appeared, which he felt was holy. What he can remember is that this black dog would not pass a certain point because the white dog was by my grandfather's side. He was able to get home, and before he could go in, both dogs were gone.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's how they describe Black Shuck. Red eyes, black. Well, even in like Harry Potter, the Grimm, if you're fans of Harry Potter, the Grimm, the wolf in the movie that's following Harry around, the Grimm is another name for Black Shuck. And of course, in the story, it ends up being Sirius Black. Right, it's not, you know, he's a werewolf or whatever, but I mean, you know, it appears in literature all the time. And yes, I mean, I've never seen it while I was awake, but like I said, two occasions, both times asleep, looked exactly the same, felt the same.
I think that's an important part, though, is you get into that state because that's almost similar to like a meditative state and especially a hypnotic state, where you're in between wake and sleep and your brain state is at a certain more suggestible area, and it's also untapping into your subconscious. So you're more open to a lot of different things that your conscious mind is normally blocking out. So you're at a higher brain activity. You're not really going to be getting into any of the stuff that most people would go like, that sounds crazy. But the thing is that it's again, that's this thing that's provable by science, is that you get into these brain states and there's things you experience, things you see, that's how remote viewing can take place. I mean, that in itself is one of those things that they sunk a lot of money into that in the government all over the world, various governments.
MK and, Ultra, all that stuff.
Yeah, and have learned all kinds of different things about different places and different beings and different sort of areas and top secret stuff that they possibly could not have known. And there's that story that's interesting about that's literally what made the Cold War end, is that both sides, with their remote viewers, there was no more secrets to discover. That they just called it off.
That's interesting.
Yeah, because the remote viewers were pretty much seeing. They were passing through each other, seeing each other's like astral presence, and it would almost just be like a day at the office, right? You're going through, and you're like, oh, that's that guy again. You know, there's Evgeny or whoever, you know, over in Russia, trying to look through us, and we're trying to go through there. And eventually, the remote viewers are like, there's nothing else.
Well, that's also why in like a lot of religions, they'll have like why they fast. It's generally if you deny your body food for a certain length of time, it makes you more susceptible to spiritual things. When Handel was writing the Messiah, which, you know, to this day, the Alleluia chorus, people still stand when they play that. But when he was writing the Messiah, when he got to that part, he had been turning away, servants had been bringing meals and he'd just leave them at the door. He was like furiously just writing and writing and would not stop. He wouldn't sleep. He wouldn't eat. And by the time he got to the end of it, he had just worked himself into an exhausted frenzy, writing all this down and notating this massive masterpiece. And he said that when he was writing the Alleluia chorus, that he collapsed on the floor and he just had a vision, and like you could see the angels and you could see heaven, and he was like, and he could hear it, and it just came, and you know, you hear these stories and you're like, this is like an artist hitting their, you know, hitting that next level, like,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
of creation, where it's like, because if you believe creation comes from somewhere else or creative power comes from a higher power, then the closer you get
into
to that,
something else, totally.
Yes, then it just floods out onto you. I mean, people still play it to this day. It has just as much impact, and it was written in, you know, hundreds of years ago. So, you know, you see stuff like that, and it says a lot. And unfortunately, people don't know this stuff. This isn't taught. Nobody talks about it. No one's hearing these stories unless you're into music or, you know, no one knows this stuff.
Yeah, even so, the devil's chord with that diminished.
Yeah, yeah.
that's so prevalent in every form of rock music.
Uh huh. It's the first note in Jesus Christ Superstar. Like the very beginning, Andrew Lloyd Webber's like, we're going to open the show with the devil's chord. That's great.
Well, it's interesting just because of the fact that it was believed for the longest time, and I mean, there's a lot of things going into like the divinity of sound, and all kinds of other things like that just where it's sound is just it's math that you can hear, mm-hmm. you know, and these frequencies can sort of summon thing. I mean, they summon emotions. Feelings and emotion within us, you know. Mm-hmm. So Lord knows what else they could actually summon in some capacity, especially when certain things, even the stories within the Bible with, you know, bringing on the walls of Jericho and everything with just a bunch of trumpets and just horns blowing, you know, it's interesting that there's been so much based on that. Even the idea that people think that sound was utilized to do certain things to move these gigantic stones and whatnot. Even that weird story of Coral Castle in Florida.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That dude put that all together and all people would hear. He's just one dude with like a simple pulley lever system thing, bringing these massive things together, and all they could hear is just humming all the time. He's doing humming at a certain, like this weird hum. And he was claiming that he understood and unlocked the secret of the ancients of how they moved these impossibly difficult, huge things. It's
saw that on really In Search weird. Of. Is that? Did you used to watch In Search of? Leonard Nimoy? Great show.
Yeah, that was a great show. Yeah. There's so much about it. And what I loved about those shows is then I would go into it because I'm like, especially when I would start, I'm like, oh, this sounds like total BS. And then you look into it and you're like, oh, my Lord. You start going down all these rabbit holes. And it's even more interesting than even what they cover on the shows.
Right, right. It's just a brief little bit that they're talking
about.
Well, that's what I found interesting when you're talking about your experience, that you were talking about so much about sound. A lot of times people just talk about what they're seeing, but you were really getting specific about things you were hearing. And that's, I mean, that's very telling because, you know, it's like music. Why does one song, why do a certain arrangement of chords make you sad? Why do a certain arrangement of chords uplift you? Why do scores in movies work so well? You know, you take the music out, the movie loses like half of its intensity. It's all gone, you know?
Yeah.
But it
definitely... Or even being together with a crowd at like a sporting event or a concert, or being together with a crowd at a somber event, like a memorial or a funeral. You know, you feel the difference in energy among a mass of people even when they're all together, and especially with that sound. All I could think is, you know, I've been a hockey fan my whole life. You go into a hockey game and they score that goal and the crowd erupts, you know, and that's it's such a feeling, just that energy is ridiculous, you know, and that means something. It's not just a simple feeling of, oh, I'm glad that thing happened. It's the energy, the impact of the sound, of the people being there, all in this state of mind together. It really hits. There's a resonance.
I'm sorry I've led you off the path of cryptids we were talking all about.
This is paranormal. The whole point of the show. Okay. It's okay.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, yeah, I was like, am I talking about Nessie enough? Do I need to get back on Nessie?
No, the whole point of the show is this, is because everything is connected, you know?
Right, right.
So you could start with one thing and then it just ends up connecting into everything else. And that's what I love about all this stuff.
I want to make sure I'm on topic.
I'm not astray. I'm not compartmentalized. I know some people really are, that they're super compartmentalized. Like, you know, they believe in ghosts, but aliens, you know, it's fooey. They believe in Bigfoot, but ghosts and demons and what, it make no sense, you know. I think it's all possible. It's all very much been cataloged over the course of human history. And that if it is all real, and I'm going to accept that it is, then it's all connected. Mm-hmm. Because everything's connected. So it all has an impact upon something else. And I mean, we can just see that in the normal physical world. In terms of just everything else, there's no way that it's not connected and it doesn't have to do with each other. But yeah, that's how we'll get on these all of a sudden. We go on these tangents because it's a tangent, but it's not really a tangent.
Right. Yeah, it's sort of a side chapter in the book that is the paranormal, I guess.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I'm glad people are digging the conversation, too. And it's good. That's the thing, is that these kind of conversations, especially when we lean a bit more into the paranormal and the possible, or the impossible, I should even say, I like that it gets people thinking, it gets them engaged with it, and they start going like, yeah, I got to look into some of that. And, you know, it makes them recall maybe experiences that they've had and things like that as well, because I feel like there's an isolation to it that the internet and social media kind of also has managed to break down a bit when it comes to stuff like this. Because when before all of that, you're experiencing this or you're looking it up, and it's a lot like feeling like you're kind of crazy and you're all alone and you're into it, but you know, should you really talk about it? And then nowadays it feels like, wow, you know, there's a lot more people that have had these experiences or are into this stuff than we probably ever realized.
Right. Yeah. And I used to not tell those stories to very many people about the dog and the black shuck and the thing at Gettysburg. Cause it just, you know, people just would look at you and be like, are you not, like, whatever, yeah, like you're a little weird. But you know, at this point I'm like, I don't care. I mean, it happened. Take it for what you interpret it, however you want to interpret it. And I think, like you said, people are getting a little more comfortable opening up about things like that than they used to be, simply because enough people have been talking about unusual sort of, we live in such a bizarre time anyways.
Yeah.
People, you know, I don't think anything surprises anybody anymore. Like, yeah, it figures. Yeah, aliens, okay. You know, maybe Bigfoot is real. Oh, you saw a demon in
your bedroom? Like, it's about time we all just lay our cards on the table, you know. Stop it with putting on airs.
Right, right.
we're all into the weirdness. Yeah. We're all wondering things, you know. And and I think that's how we'll actually get somewhere that matters, is once we all stop pretending that we're so knowledgeable and so confident in all the things that we know, that there's no such thing that we could possibly not know.
Right.
You know, and that's, yeah, I think that's a good place to be.
The hubris and the arrogance of our generations today, even that we look back at previous generations hundreds of years ago and judge them as if they're in our situation. Like, how dare they do that? Well, you're not in their shoes. You live now. They lived then. You don't have a right to judge their behavior because you didn't live in their time, you know. But we're just so, like, it's almost like a self-righteous period where people just think, we've got it all figured out now, and we're so enlightened. Oh, those fools back then, they didn't know what they were doing. I hate that. Like, to me, that is just, and that's actually before the fall. You know, the whole pride cometh before a fall.
Yep.
You know, you're about to learn a hard lesson that you don't know as much about this world as you think, if that's your outlook.
That's the funny part too, is that it's antithetical to knowledge and wisdom to believe you already know everything there is to know.
Right.
So these people that run around like, oh, I know everything, you actually don't know shit.
Right. Yeah, the wise person is the one that says, I'm still learning.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you know, and I don't, and there's a lot I still don't know. Actually, the older I get, the more I feel like, the less I feel like I know. Honestly.
Yeah, because you start breaking down certain things and you're like, man, I thought I knew a lot about that. Mm-hmm. And it turns out I don't know a whole lot about it at all. You know, but that's the kind of thing that for some people, I think it keeps them still engaged and fascinated with what it is to even just be alive.
Right. And if nothing else, it fuels our creativity. Like, you know,
totally.
What we're writing, you've got to have that sense of wonder and possibility to create anything. It's why a lot of popular entertainment today isn't interesting. It's amazing when you take spiritual things or otherworldly sort of inspiration out of your life, how mundane and uninteresting your art becomes really quickly. Because, I mean, most of the greatest art throughout human history was inspired, either financed through the church or inspired through some sort of reaching something greater than humanity. And when we stop doing that in the postmodern era, now we're in the post-postmodern era, architecture got uglier, movies got worse, music got worse.
Yeah, just a complete rejection of anything and everything that's come before. In an effort to strive to be so original that you're just making crap, because that's what generally hasn't been made yet in a prevalent way, is just a lot of crap.
Deconstruction. Let's deconstruct everything.
Yeah.
Let's just tear it all down. No one wants to see that. I'm sorry. That's not. You may think you're cute doing it, and yes, it was relevant in the 1920s, 1930s. It's not relevant anymore. No, there's nothing original about deconstructing anything anymore. Like, people want to get back to good storytelling.
Absolutely. You know? Yeah, that's the thing, too, is that for the longest time, what resonated with people was the pursuit of the beautiful, which was truth, trying to find as much of the truth in something as was possible. Right. And even though there were a lot of obstacles and hurdles in the way, that was always what was the search of trying to figure that out. Mm-hmm. And then we did hit a certain point, especially when it comes to culture, where it was almost like this light went off, that they went, wow, you know what? We're all still trying to do this. Why don't we do the opposite of that? That's the thing. Well, the opposite of that's horrible. Why do you want to pursue that?
Yeah.
You know, like, we still have so much more to figure out, but it's because we thought we figured everything out. So now it's time to deconstruct it, because aren't we so clever?
But now they're deconstructing things that have been deconstructed. So it's a deconstruction deconstruction.
Yes.
So it's just a total wreck. I don't ever want to hear another director or writer go, I want to subvert expectations.
Yep.
God, I hate that. I'm like, I didn't pay you to subvert my expectations.
How about you try to exceed some expectations? How about that?
If I'm going to see an action movie, let there be action. If I see a comedy, I want it to be funny. If, you know, if it's a horror movie, can it be scary? Don't subvert my expectations. Give me exactly what I want.
Can someone finally just go in there? And I know we see this a lot in the indie scene, because we are trying to do this. We're trying. We're trying to aim for something. And maybe it's out of our grasp a bit, but we're going to fail gloriously, if anything. I want to see someone just go in there and be like, I'm going to try to just make the best possible thing I could make that people are going to love. And maybe 100 years from now, I'm dead and gone, but people are going to love this thing and it's going to mean something to them.
Yes. Yes.
Can we just have people that say that? I mean, that would be incredible to hear someone be like, I want people to be moved by this. I want it to matter to people. I want this to resonate and live past, you know, the people who even see it. I want it to be generations from now, they'll talk about this and it'll mean something to them too.
Well, that's why I think what we're doing, especially with crowdfunded books and things like that, they have to be passion projects. They require so much work, so much money, so much time, so much effort, so much risk. You can't afford to invest all that into something you don't believe in and you don't intend to make great. Now, some of us may hit the mark more than others, but that's the point, is at least we're trying, right? I mean, at least we're trying to give people what we think they want. And, you know, I don't ever want to subvert expectations. I want to give people at least the minimum what they came for, if not, like you said, exceed it.
Totally. Yeah. Yeah, and that should be the goal, to strive for something great, to achieve something great, something that will matter, something that will last, as opposed to the stuff that's just like you said, the we're in like the post deconstruction era where all we do is decide to deconstruct the deconstruction, and it's so how about
so
we
bad.
Can we start building yet? We've deconstructed enough. Can we start constructing again? Let's start doing that. That would be great.
And here's the thing, I would think, well, I'm just that old man complaining about in my day, but honestly, no. I was listening to music and watching movies that were made when I was a kid, long before I was even born, and I recognized them as great, and they were from previous generations.
Same
but
here,
I
man.
I still recognize them as great. So don't give me this, well, it's just because you're old and you
nostalgia
don't
and
no,
the
no,
yada
no,
yada.
No.
Nope.
There may be one or two good movies that come out every year when there used to be like 10. Go back and pull up 1984, 1985, 1986.
Oh, Lord.
Look at how many classics were coming out in 1 year. It was shocking. The same summer. I showed it to my son. He just about fell over. He couldn't believe it. He's like, wait a minute, RoboCop came out the same year as Platoon?
Or Predator.
And Predator and Lost Boys. And you're like, these all came out in the same summer? I was like, yeah, dude. Like, this is the movies back when we were growing up. It was just like one hit after classic after another. And you're lucky if you get one of those every couple of years now, if that, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah, and that's why when they keep trying to go back into remaking these things to just capture a little bit of what made them successful, they keep missing the whole point of it entirely.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the remakes. I don't think I've ever seen a remake I liked, other than maybe John Carpenter's The Thing, but that was a remake in the 80s.
Of the only ones I've ever seen, same thing, would be like Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Yeah. Or The Blob, 87 Blob.
Or that,
excellent.
Even The Fly, Cronenberg's Fly.
Yeah, that was great too. So it can be done, but you have to do it better. You have to make it even better.
Exactly, because they were striving while also going, we have to keep the heart of what this story's about.
Yeah.
You know, it's not just a cheap cash in, you know, and let's make it gimmicky and you know, hey, remember that thing that you saw? Yeah, come back and see the remake of it. Why? Why would you want it? I can just watch that one I really like.
Keep making crap, guys, because we'll just fill the gaps. I mean, that's what we're gonna do. Is the goal, obviously, of independence is we got to start filling the void, the entertainment void that, you know, it's getting wider and wider and wider. I mean, look at the movies that are bombing, these massive studio films that are just bombing, and people would rather watch YouTube than watch these movies.
It's incredible. And even for me, it was a time where I was like, wow, would I just sit here and not just do a show, but listen to shows and just spend most of my time just digging through whatever's on YouTube in terms of interviews, in terms of documentaries, in terms of all of that? I would say probably not. And if anything, that's the majority of what I watch nowadays is that, because it's just not happening at the mainstream level.
It'll come back. It'll come back. I mean, creativity will never die.
We'll all bring it back. And that includes the viewers, too, and everybody else that's out there. So even if you're someone who you're not in a creative capacity, but you're someone who enjoys seeing it get made or the conversation take place or the behind-the-scenes process or whatever, you guys are just as integral, if not even more so, because you enable people to do what they're doing. To that whole process. And I think we're seeing that. I think humanity is kind of starting to reach its boiling point with the nonsense, you know, and it's hitting that point of it wants the pursuit for greatness. It wants the ability to say that, yes, you can strive. Yes, you'll struggle, but you can still achieve. It's still attainable to achieve something that maybe hasn't been achieved before. And do it in a way that means something and matters, as opposed to, you know, you can achieve something, but does it really, anyone going to give a crap? Is it really going to matter? You know, instead of this fleeting kind of nature of it all. But man, oh man, what a great conversation tonight, man. Justin, thank you so much, brother.
Thanks for having me on, man.
Appreciate it. It was great. As far as War Party goes, this is still in demand, and I know you've got it going through comic shops as well, right?
Yeah, it's you know, I went through Diamond, and you know, I don't know which shops carry it. As you know, they don't really tell you that. But I mean, it's the usuals. It's Midtown Comics and Golden Apple and the big stores that tend to buy everything. So it's out there. It's doing fairly well. It's actually doing better than I expected, honestly. But it's great. It's great to be out there. I'm glad I set it up the way I did, because I was able to sort of transition right into retail immediately, because they're floppies and I priced them. I was getting a lot of criticism on crowdfunding for pricing it too low. They're like, he's only charging $3.99 a book. I said, well, that's what you'd pay in the store. Yes, but this is crowdfunding. You're supposed to charge $10 a book. I'm like, I'm not charging $10 for a 32-page comic book. So I priced them low because I knew that eventually I would want to take that stock and put it out there in the marketplace. So it worked out that way. So it's you know, I'm glad I did it the way I did it, I guess is what I'm saying. Rather than
good,
the,
man.
The
I'm glad to hear. Is it going well with the distribution side of it? And you don't have to divulge.
Yeah. I mean, I've worked with Diamond since the 90s, because I published comics back when I was in high school. So I started publishing in 92. So right when the Image thing started. And it was my self-published Civil War comic when I was still in high school. And so I've been dealing with Diamond ever since, but you know, on and off. And you know, I'm old school. I like to have my books in the stores. I mean, it's just, to me, reaching as many people as possible is important to me. You know, am I making money off that? Not really. And it's kind of breaks even, but the money I make is off the crowdfunding, because obviously you're getting full price.
Yeah.
I kind of treat it almost like it's a marketing expense. In other words, if it covers itself and I can get them to the stores, that's one more potential reader that then may come and buy directly from me down the line, or keep buying at the store is fine too. But I want to get readers, you know, I want to get as many out there, and I'm sure you understand that as a publisher. It's going well, and I have big plans in the future for other books.
I hope it continues to go well for you, man. I wish you nothing but success with it. And seriously, it was a great conversation tonight. Where can people go to learn more about you, support you, all that good stuff?
I'm Professor Murph on YouTube, so definitely check out my channel. I don't post a lot, but I'm going to get better about it. and I'm also Rampart Press is my publishing company. That's on Twitter or X. That's Rampart Press on Twitter, Professor Murph on YouTube. And other than that, you know, that's pretty much those are two places I hang out. I'm on Instagram too. Yeah, Professor Murph on Instagram. So.
Awesome. Do I follow you on there?
I don't know.
I don't know if I do. I got to check. I'll check. If I don't, I'll rectify that.
Cool.
Thank you guys for watching tonight. It was a fun conversation.
Yeah.
And Rick, hello, and I'm going to have to give you a goodbye, but it was good seeing you on here, Rick. Everybody. Thank you guys so much. Really appreciate you guys being here. Tomorrow night, I'll be back at 9 o'clock Eastern with B.A. Turner. We're going to be talking about his comic. I'm going to be talking about gargoyles and stuff with him, too, so that should be fun. But thank you guys so much. And again, if you haven't had a chance yet to check out Alternoween, make sure you do so. There's only about 12 days left, the last day of September 25th, to back that campaign. It's on Fund My Comic, Indiegogo, and AlternaComics.com. And also, I didn't want to mention this because I don't like doing this. It feels like you're patting yourself on the back about charity. But so you guys know, every $1,000 that we raise on the Alternoween campaign, I'm donating 100 books to Comic Books for Kids so they can get it out to kids in children's hospitals that can't go out for Halloween night. So right now we're at 1250 on the campaign. 100 books are definitely getting donated. Hopefully we can raise more than that and then get more books out. But thank you guys for being a part of that, making it possible. And if you haven't had a chance, check out King Cryptid. It's on Indiegogo and Alterna Comics as well. We're funding issues 5-9 and 1-4 are on there right now. In case you missed out, you can get them on alternacomics.com. Get them delivered to you very soon. And then you can decide whether or not you'd like to read 5-9. But other than that, thank you guys so much. If you like the show, give it a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, all that good stuff. And go check out War Party, which is on Indiegogo, or maybe even at your local comic shop. Make sure to ask them about it too. Let them know. Bang the drum for Rampart Press and get War Party in your local comic shop. Everybody, take it easy. Have a wonderful night, and I'll see you guys tomorrow.
Thanks.